alligator meat. Not my favorite thing in the world, but you might like it. It's super nutritious, really low in saturated fat, and it's probably the case that alligator farming has played a big role in saving these important critters from extinction. They were hunted to the brink by the mid-20th century, more for their skins than for the meat. The meat was mostly a byproduct of the leather industry. Might as well not let it go to waste, right? I'm gonna tell you how this meat is produced, how you cook it, and what it tastes like. I'm leaning heavily here on this recent scholarly review of alligator aquaculture research linked in the description, but first, what even are alligators, and why aren't they crocodiles? Well, in a sense they are. Alligators are of the order Crocodilia, which originated about 100 million years ago. They aren't dinosaurs, but they shared some time with the dinosaurs and were closely related to them. Still are, in fact, because Crocodilia are the living animals most closely related to birds. And birds are dinosaurs. Did you get that memo, by the way? Because I somehow missed it. I mean, back in school, they taught us that birds are descended from dinosaurs. But in the intervening years, a clear scientific consensus has emerged that birds literally are dinosaurs, the last living dinosaurs. They're theropods, just like the T-Rex. Do you realize what this means? This means dino nuggets are the most scientifically accurate shape of nugget. It also means that birds are clearly, unambiguously, reptiles, even though historically they weren't considered as such. And that helps explain why alligator meat tastes so much like chicken. Gators and chickens are cousins. But anyway, crocodiles. The collection of species known as true crocodiles are indigenous to tropical waters all over the planet. They're big, aggressive. Alligators, on the other hand, are indigenous to only two places. There's a species in eastern China, and there's a species in southeastern North America, where I am. I saw these guys in Florida. Alligators are generally a little smaller than true crocodiles and not quite as aggressive. Gators do swamps and marshes, not open water, and they prefer fresh water. Alligators also range pretty far beyond the tropics. A crocodile gets cold, it straight up dies. Alligators can thrive like surprisingly far north here in the United States, and that's in part due to behavioral adaptations. They're nocturnal in the summer and diurnal in the winter, and in the dead of winter they brumate, which is the reptile equivalent of hibernation. They stick their snout above water, let it freeze around their nose, and they breathe through the hole as they just chill. Alligators will occasionally kill people, but they also keep other destructive pests in check. Plus, they burrow holes in the marshes that become crucial habitat for lots of other animals. So it mattered when the leather industry drove gator populations critically low across much of their native range by the 1950s and 60s. Gators are a big part of the cultural identity of Louisiana, where the meat has been used in Cajun and Creole cuisine for centuries, and it was Louisiana that first made efforts to protect alligators. They banned hunting outright in 1962. 5 years later, the US federal government did the same. This must have been a kind of hard thing to do politically. Unless the animal is furry and cute, people usually aren't that interested in protecting big, scary apex predators like snakes or crocs or sharks. But this shark wants to protect you, Surfshark, the sponsor of this video. Surfshark is dedicated to stopping spammers, scammers, and spies from taking a bite out of you. You sign up and you get all these tools you need to stay safe on the internet. Surfshark Search, a search engine with no ads or trackers. Surfshark Alert lets you know if any of your personal information or passwords appear in leaked databases. CleanWeb, it blocks ads, malware, and phishing attempts. And of course, there's the virtual private network. You route your connection through any one of Surfshark's thousands of encrypted servers all over the world. Do that and nobody on your Wi-Fi network can snoop on you, and you can get around government censorship or location-based service denials from streaming companies, for example. You can even turn on the kill switch and your connection will drop automatically if you ever lose the VPN. Swim on down to my link in the description, use the code ADAMRAGUSIA, and you'll get 83% off Surfshark with an additional 3 months for free. Link and code in the description, save 83%. Thank you, Surfshark. So anyway, the state of Louisiana banned gator hunting in the 1960s. They also funded a lot of research into gator reproduction and habitat management, and with that data, they were able to launch a sustainable use program that has been a tremendous success. The wild population rebounded so fast that they were off the endangered species list by 1987. Limited hunting is allowed again, and farming is allowed. Alligators are farmed across the coastal southeast, but the epicenter of the industry is Louisiana. There's about 2 million wild gators in the state today, and about 500,000 on farms. Well, technically they're ranches. It's pretty easy to keep alligators in captivity. It's really hard to breed them in captivity. They simply need lots of open space for their mating and courtship rituals. So, a lot of alligator farmers in the United States source their eggs from the wild. That's a tricky job, not only because there is likely to be an angry mama alligator nearby, but also you have to keep the eggs upright. If you turn alligator eggs upside down, the embryo dies. So what they do is they mark the top, and they very carefully transfer the eggs back to the farm to an incubator. There, the baby alligators have a much better chance of survival than they do in the wild. Once they've grown to a meter and a half, the farmers return 12% of them to the wild. That figure reflects the number of animals that likely would have successfully hatched and survived had the eggs remained in the nest. So farming alligators helps wild alligators by relieving hunting pressure on them, and swiping those wild eggs does not hurt the wild alligators, just the opposite in fact. The market for wild eggs creates an economic incentive for landowners to preserve alligator habitat. They make money by allowing egg collectors on their land, so it's in their interest to preserve vital wetlands. Alligator farming can be a tricky business, though. Remember that the meat is historically a byproduct. The real money has been in the skins, most of which are still exported to France and Italy. Capricious fashion trends create huge year-to-year swings in the market demand for gator leather. Some farmers are able to supplement their income by making their farms into tourist attractions. I shot all this footage at a tourist trap. Pay some money and feed the gators. The meat also offers a more stable market to farmers. There's even research on how discarded alligator fat could be sold for biofuels. All that said, people do have some particular ethical concerns about gator farming. For one thing, these animals are not domesticated. Humans have bred cows over millennia to thrive on our ranches. Gators are still genetically wild, and there's research indicating particular levels of physiological stress among gators in captivity. Though the ones hatched in captivity do seem to do a lot better, those males are less aggressive toward each other, for example. Certainly, humane and sanitary conditions could vary from farm to farm, but farmers do have an economic incentive to keep the tanks clean and not too crowded. If things get gross in there, disease spreads and they lose money. Animal rights groups have also raised concern about slaughter, which in the US generally involves using the same kind of captive bolt gun that they use to knock cows. This destroys or shuts down the animal's brain before it is bled out. The concern is that maybe alligators are just harder to kill, more likely to still be conscious when they're cut. That seems like it could be true to me. I can imagine that might be true, but I've not been able to find any kind of scientific research documenting that this is a particular problem with alligator harvest. There's one study that finds captive bolt and similar methods to be pretty effective at extinguishing consciousness, if it's done properly. I worry that could be a big if. There's an ongoing legal fight between Louisiana and California over gator products. California wants to ban imports of any dead gator parts. One of the stronger arguments in favor of that ban is that American gator products look really similar to products made from species that are still critically endangered. As this argument goes, the only way that you can stamp out trade in endangered crocodilia is by stamping out trade in all crocodilia. And that makes sense to me. It's certainly true that there is a social stigma here in the US against wearing exotic animal skins, and the market for gator leather has been in decline here. This brings us back to the meat. People generally consider the choicest meat to be from the tail. These are tail pieces, often called loins. There's two sides of it. The bones would have been in the middle between them there. This meat looks and feels and tastes a lot like poultry white meat. Yes, that's because they're closely related animals, but also because this muscle tissue does a job similar to the one performed by chicken breast. These muscles are for sudden, explosive effort. Chickens don't fly long distances continuously, right? They just kind of hover for a second. So there's not much red myoglobin in this tissue for storing oxygen for long-term sustained effort, and it's filled with fast-twitch muscle fibers that are for short, strong bursts. Same deal with the gator tail. They don't use it continuously. They mostly laze around all day. They just need short bursts of propulsion when they pounce. Some of their muscles they use more frequently, like the meat around their legs. That's the dark meat, which you can also buy, but it's less popular. Also less popular is the meat from the body, which has this kind of flaked texture to it with these ribbons of fat running through it. You can see a bit of that in the structure of this tail meat. In the body, it's more pronounced, and the meat can have this weird spongy texture if you don't grind it into sausage or burgers or something. Like all large and long-lived aquatic predators, alligators can also accumulate mercury in their muscle from the contaminated smaller fish that they eat. It's the same thing that happens with tuna and swordfish, though there's no mercury advisory against gator meat as yet. It's probably a much bigger deal with wild gator. Wild gator meat can also taste a little bit fishy. People say that it tastes like fish, feels like chicken. This farmed gator that I got had no fishy taste whatsoever. It was also pretty tender because farmed alligators are usually harvested young, maybe a year and a half. In the wild, gators can live as long as a person, getting bigger and tougher every year. This, you could easily have told me was chicken breast, and I'd have been fooled. Or maybe turkey. Since it's a larger animal, the meat grain is a little more coarse, like the breast from a turkey. There's very little research on foodborne illness and gator meat. There have been some documented outbreaks of salmonella among the gators on gator farms. I don't know, I would probably cook it the same temperature you do with chicken, not just for safety, but also for taste. Because this tail muscle is the same kind of tissue as in chicken breast, it has that same slimy texture that chicken breast has when it's really undercooked. Like I said, it's not my favorite thing, and I do have ethical concerns about it, but certainly alligators show us that conservation is a complicated topic. Killing animals can be a way to save them.